Hi, this is Chapter 2, Section 2, Measured Numbers and Significant Figures. Measured numbers are numbers that come from using an instrument to measure some quantity, such as height, weight, or temperature. When using any instrument, the precision of the measurement obtained always depends on the scale or sensitivity of the instrument itself. Some instruments are analog, which means they are graduated or divided into unit marks, and the measurement is based on observing how some continuous property lines up with this scale. This is how a ruler or an old mercury thermometer work. Other instruments are digital, which usually means the property being observed produces some electrical response in the instrument, which is then used to compute the measurement. A digital weight scale is a good example of this kind of instrument. For a digital instrument, the device will already be designed and calibrated to display the measurement for you with the correct precision. You can just write down all the numbers you see on the digital display. For analog instruments, however, the precision is determined by the smallest unit division marked on it, and it may take some practice to understand how to report the measurement from it. The rule is that the measurement will include all the digits that you're certain of based on the instrument marks, and one more digit that estimates how far the measurement extends between the smallest marks. The best way to understand this is to practice, so let's take a look at these three examples of measuring a wooden stick with a ruler. In the first case, it should be very clear that the stick starts at the zero mark and extends past the 4 centimeter mark, but not quite to the 5 centimeter mark. This tells us that the measurement is 4 centimeters plus a little extra, so we know that the ones place is a 4. However, we can still make a pretty good estimate of the next smallest place value. In this case, it looks like the stick is about halfway between the marks. So we can estimate that the measurement is about 4.5 or 4.5 centimeters. Keep in mind that this is an estimate though, so another person might look at the same instrument and decide that the stick is maybe 4.4 centimeters or 4.6 centimeters. Even though that last digit has some uncertainty in this sense, it is still reported as a significant figure in the measurement. Any more digits than that would just be a complete guess, so we stop there. In the second example, the situation is very similar, but the ruler has smaller unit marks. Each centimeter is divided up into 10 equal pieces, which you should recognize as millimeters. In this picture, it's hard to see where the end of the stick is in relation to those marks, so let's magnify it a little. Looking closer, we can see that the end of the stick is past the fifth mark, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but not quite at the sixth, here. This tells us that the measurement is definitely 4.5 centimeters plus a little extra. Again, the little extra is going to be estimated in the next digit. It's about halfway again, so we would read this as 4.55 centimeters. The last example here looks a little simpler at first, but we have to keep in mind the precision of the ruler itself. Most students read this simply as 3 centimeters, but when the smallest divisions are centimeters, we have to estimate our reading to the next smallest place value, tenths of a centimeter. Even when the reading appears to fall exactly at one of the marks, like this one does, we need to indicate the precision by including another digit. In this case, we wouldn't report this as 3 centimeters, but rather as 3.0 centimeters. The difference may seem trivial, but precision is very important in science, especially since a measurement like this may be used for other calculations down the road. This brings us to the concept of significant figures or significant digits, which I mentioned briefly in the last chapter. The significant figures in a measurement are the digits that we can confidently report based on the precision of the instrument. Take this example. A student measures their height with a meter stick. Which of these choices makes the most sense for how the results of this measurement should be reported? The first choice is 1 meter. But even the crudest meter stick can give a precision down to a half or even a third of a meter, so we would expect one more digit of precision at least. So this one is no good. The next choice is 1.143387 meters. Here, you should notice that that last digit, the 2, is actually in the 10 millionths place. In other words, this number is implying that the student used a meter stick to measure their own height with an uncertainty of only a tenth of a micron. That's something like 10 to 100 times smaller than the width of a human hair. Obviously, this is absurd. The last choice here is 1.14 meters, which is actually 1 meter and 14 centimeters. Since most meter sticks do have at least centimeter marks on them, this is a much more reasonable result. It's more or less equivalent to stating your height to a half an inch. Now we've seen that determining the significant figures in a measurement is really a matter of figuring out the precision of the instrument. But what happens when we didn't make the measurement ourselves, or the number in question is the result of a calculation based on multiple measurements? In cases like these, we have to rely on certain conventions and rules to tell us what digits are significant and can be trusted. These are the rules for figuring out which digits are significant in a given number. First, every non-zero digit is significant, and any zero between non-zero digits is significant. If the given number has a decimal in it, then we would also include any zeros at the end of the number on the right-hand side as significant. These two rules are actually all you need to know about significant figures, although putting them into practice can be confusing at times. It might help to look at it from another perspective. Which digits in a number aren't significant? Looking at it from this angle, we can say that any leading zeros, zeros at the beginning or left-hand side of the number, can always be dropped as insignificant. Any trailing zeros, zeros at the end or the right-hand side of a number, can be dropped only if the number does not have a decimal indicated explicitly. If it is a decimal, we have to keep those trailing zeros as significant, just like we said up here. The last point here is not really a separate rule, but it may help you to remember that when a number is given in scientific notation, we can assume all the digits in the coefficient are significant. We already saw this in action when we learned in the last chapter that you keep all the significant figures in a number when you write the coefficient. This chart gives us an opportunity to review some of these rules. In these first numbers, we can note that every digit is non-zero, so they're all significant. This first number has 1, 2 significant figures, and this second number has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 significant figures. In these two examples, we see that there are zeros between non-zero digits, so we have to count those as significant too. So this one has 3 significant figures, 1, 2, 3, and this one has 1, 2, 3, 4 significant figures in total. In this row, there are 2 numbers that contain decimal points, and so we need to include these zeros on the right-hand side as well, here, here, and here. So this first one has 2 digits in total, and this second one has 4 significant figures in total. For these two numbers in scientific notation, we count every digit in the coefficients, so this one has 2 and this one has 3 significant figures. In these last examples, we can ignore these zeros here, 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 and here. In this case, because we can always ignore zeros on the left-hand side, and in this case, because you can ignore zeros on the right-hand side, as long as there's no decimal point. So this figure here has just 1 significant figure, the 4. This here has 1, 2 significant figures. This number has 2 significant figures and you ignore the zeros. This has 3 significant figures and you ignore the zeros. On this slide, we see how to use the significant figures in a number to write the coefficient for that number when it's put into scientific notation. It also allows us to see the difference between numbers with and without a decimal point. So for the first set of numbers, there's no decimal point, which means we can ignore all of these trailing zeros here and here. So this number has just 1 significant figure, and this number has 2 significant figures. For the second set here, there is a decimal explicitly written, so we can include the trailing zeros on the right-hand side here and here. Just remember that you always ignore leading zeros on the left-hand side. So this first number has 1, 2, 3 significant figures, and this second number has 1, 2, 3, 4 significant figures. Now notice that when you put these numbers into scientific notation, all of the significant figures are included in the coefficients, even in cases where you're including zeros at the end. Sometimes you need to indicate that a zero which looks insignificant actually is significant. In cases like this, you can put a decimal in the number, but it's usually better to write the number in scientific notation. This example illustrates why. 5,100 without a decimal place, here, has only two significant figures, the 5 and the 1. But with the decimal place, here, all four digits are significant. It's hard to tell them apart in standard notation, but writing them in scientific notation makes it much clearer, because you know that the entire coefficient is significant. Now let's look at some more examples. Again, I'll give you a few seconds to pause the video and try to work through them on your own before we look at the answers. When you're ready, the first number is 0.002650 meters. We can start by counting all the non-zero digits as significant, and ignoring the leading zeros on the left. Then we have to count the trailing zero on the right, because there's a decimal point in the number. That gives us four significant figures in total, the 2, the 6, the 5, and just this last zero. To put this number into scientific notation, you take all four significant figures, and you place the decimal point after the first one. This makes the coefficient something between 1 and 10, in this case 2.650. Then you have to figure out how many places you moved the decimal point from where it began, here, to where it ended, here. In this case, you went 1, 2, 3 spaces. So the power is going to be positive or negative 3. Since this is a small number, it's a negative 3. So in scientific notation, this is 2.650 times 10 to the negative third power. For this example, the number is 43.026. In this case, there are no leading or trailing zeros to worry about. All we have are non-zero digits here and here, and a zero in between them. That means every digit here is significant, and they all go into the coefficient. You place the decimal after the first digit, and then figure out how many places you had to move it. Since it went from here to here, you moved it one place, and since the number originally was greater than 10, that means it's a positive one in the exponent. So in scientific notation, this is 4.3026 times 10 to the first power. In this case, we keep the non-zero digits here and here, as well as the zero between them here, so that you end up with four significant figures. Placing the decimal to the right of the first digit, you get a coefficient of 1.044. Then we have to see how many places we moved. The decimal started here, and it moved 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 places to get there. Since the original number was much greater than 10, obviously, this is a positive 6. So the answer in scientific notation is 1.044 times 10 to the sixth power. At this point, we've talked a lot about measured numbers and their inherent uncertainty. But not every quantitative observation works this way. Some numbers are found by counting discrete items, like cookies or eggs, while others arrive from certain definitions or conventions, like the relationships between different units within a measurement system. These numbers are called exact, and you can think of them as being infinitely precise. This chart shows some more examples of exact numbers, including some objects that you can count, and some unit definitions. Note that relationships between two units in different systems are not exact, except in a few rare cases because of the way that they're defined. To finish out this section, let's take a look at some numbers and figure out whether they're measured or exact. The numbers we're looking at are three coins, a circle diameter of 7.902 centimeters, and the relationship between minutes and hours. The first one is simple enough because we know that you can count pennies and you don't typically encounter a piece or a fraction of one. This makes it an exact counted number. It's tempting to say that this number has no significant figures, but in fact the opposite is true. It actually has an unlimited number of significant figures. We just don't want to write out an infinite number of zeros after the decimal. The next one is clearly the result of a measurement. Length is a continuous property that's typically measured with a ruler or tape measure and has some uncertainty. This particular number has four significant figures. The last example is that 60 minutes equals 1 hour. Since these units are part of the same system, we can conclude that this is an exact relationship with unlimited precision.